and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where the Titanic just ran into another iceberg. The MCU! That's right, for 22 years, which fascinatingly may be showing that its fate is the exact number of movies that the MCU has had to date. It's not fate, but it does play nicely into the mythology, the Hollywood mythology that we're building here. But it took 22 years and Marvel 22 movies to top James Cameron, where in the past no one could do so but James Cameron. It's an amazing accomplishment. The only place Cameron still has an edge is the Oscars, right? And I made a video about that. It's unlikely for Avengers Endgame, but not impossible. The link to that video is down below in the video description. But anyway, while James Cameron was already a Hollywood legend by the time he'd made Titanic, in fact, switching lanes from hardcore sci-fi action to hardcore romance, and to be fair, hardcore historical action, James Cameron, it's interesting. He's as big a genius as the Russo brothers, I think, when it comes to constructing films, but the Russo brothers don't quite operate at the same level because they don't factor in the industry aspect of things the way James Cameron does. His films, for instance, were both much more Oscar friendly. But as for the Russo brothers, who the heck were they before Kevin Feige discovered them? I'll tell you who. They'd only made a handful of shorts, plus two quirky and, quite frankly, unsuccessful movies. But their secret weapon was the same as Feige's. And he himself, by the way, has only ever made comic book movies. I think that's also one of the reasons that maybe the MCU don't get no respect. It's getting harder and harder, though, to ignore, I think, even for old school Hollywood, their accomplishments. But anyway, both of them are fans. They do sample their own product, and it's because of that that they can cook up the most potent fan-pleasing films that Hollywood has ever seen, and the box office to go along with it. I don't want to undercut James Cameron's accomplishments, though, but I think that finally he does have, let's say, peers, which is in and of itself very interesting. Now, many of you who are watching are also fans, and you, just like the Russo brothers, could get your start with short films by entering My Road Reel, which has asked me to be a judge once again this year, and I am honored to do so. They just opened up for submissions, and Rode Microphones, based out of Australia, a film industry hub in its own right, is proud to have the largest short film competition in the world, with entries from all over the world, and anyone has a shot at winning. One of the things I like most about the competition is that we seriously consider different types of genres. Usually when it comes to film competitions, only one type of movie can win. But last year, for instance, we selected, my first year as a judge, we chose an outright comedy. So anyone from any country has a shot with any short film. And there are over $1 million worth of prizes. We talk about movies all the time here on this channel. I'm sure many of you have an idea percolating up there. And again, as a judge, I would love to see it. The deadline for submissions is August 28th. You got time? Click also down below in the video description on that link for all the details. Now, back to Avengers Endgame and where the Russo brothers are today. Again, think about where they started. It's amazing, although to some degree Kevin Feige was a little bit their fairy godmother, because James Cameron had to work his way up as a screenwriter, etc. Anyway, Titanic was a luxury liner. It took 74 days for that thing to get to $1 billion, the first film ever to do so, and it needed a re-release in 2012 to get to $2 billion, but Avengers Endgame is a damn speedboat. It crossed $1 billion in 5 days and $2 billion in a mere 11 days on Saturday. It's already well into the $2 billion club today. Interestingly though, Avatar, Infinity War, and The Force Awakens all got to $2 billion in about the same time frame, which means that a new kind of movie and a movie-going pattern, again, all driven by spoilers, has been born. Hey, Kathleen! I bet you're really regretting letting Ryan do away with all your story points and burning questions out of The Force Awakens, eh? But also, to be fair to Kathleen, the demand to get into Galaxy's Edge, where reservations went online late last week, has been impressive. It sold out in mere hours. It was like Comic-Con or something. That's very, very cool. And Disney now doesn't have to worry about nobody showing up. They're booked solid. Perhaps everyone who saw Avengers Endgame more than, let's say, 4 times should get a pass to visit the highly anticipated theme park experience, especially since California's Marvel Land, oh boy, isn't opening until spring 2020. Maybe it's hard to sometimes meet these opening dates. But it's coming soon. They're also opening Marvel experiences in France. They already have a couple in Asia, but it's very exciting. Curses to that stupid competition. They can't have Marvel properties outright in Orlando because of Universal, but they are cheating a little bit with the Guardians of the Galaxy ride, which will be opening in Epcot, I believe, in 2021. So the Marvel rides, they are a-coming, but Star Wars is first, and Star Wars seems to be off to a very good start. But yeah, Avengers Endgame is incredibly front-loaded. Gloriously so. How wonderful for Disney to get such a big chunk of change back so quickly. It's almost like they just pulled a lever and all the money comes pouring out, but they worked hard for it. So I think a better metaphor is that they struck gold, right? You gotta work hard to be a prospector, and I would say Bob Feige, I've combined them into one person. I'd say Bob Iger is a little bit of a prospector looking for veins of gold in the entertainment industry. And boy, is he good at finding them. The MCU has been quite the gold rush for Disney. In fact, the MCU has almost doubled the total box office of the second biggest franchise of all time, Star Wars. Gotta catch up, Star Wars. That's a little embarrassing. And Star Wars, by the way, of course, is also owned by Disney. Warner Brothers has the runners-up, though, although they've put both of them in serious creative and box office danger in the past year or so. By the way, while many in Hollywood like to complain that comic book movies are impossible to compete with, as you can see, I wish more people in Hollywood would actually take a look at these box office lists, not only to cheer themselves up, but for ideas, right? But Star Wars, Disney live-action fairy tales, James Bond, Middle Earth, dinosaurs, Transformers, cars on steroids, and pirates have all been able to hold their own. And they're all not owned by Disney, although an awful lot of them are. But the MCU and Star Wars are in a class by themselves. And it's important to note that each are considered stories for a generation. Every other franchise should be like, how can we become the story of a generation? It's also important to note, again, speaking of Bob Iger and his prospecting ways, neither franchise originated at Disney. Any other studio could have had the foresight to purchase them. And Bob didn't make all, he didn't go on a shopping spree. These purchases were made over time, yet still no other studio was spurred to action. And Iger, I think for that reason, definitely deserves his spot in Hollywood history and a sizable paycheck, although perhaps not the exact size that he's getting, particularly considering that many of his employees are homeless. That's bad. All right, now, especially also when you think about all this money coming in. Look at that. That's bad optics, Bob, if you do indeed have any interest in becoming president. I think if he doesn't fix that, it almost closes the book on that potential next chapter for him. Although his book has a pretty darn good ending as is. Now the question becomes, though, can Avengers Endgame top Avatar? And can it christen and break through into the $3 billion club? It has about $600 million to go before topping Avatar and about $800 million to go before reaching $3 billion. That's a tall order, even for the MCU, especially considering that Avengers Endgame is dropping, especially in China. But speaking of China, Avengers Endgame is still the third highest grossing film there ever, behind two local films, which is, again, as we've discussed, why Kevin Feige is fast-tracking a Shang-Chi movie. They also have a number of theme parks in Asia, two in China, and Shang-Chi would be an asset there as well. A director is already set, a friend of Brie Larson. I wanted Alan Yang. I think this guy got the edge because of the Brie Larson recommendation. And maybe Captain Marvel will lend an assist in that movie. I think that would be a double-edged sword for that film, but considering the fact she probably got him the job, he should be all smiles about it. Expect a release date and casting for Shang-Chi to be a top priority in the pending Phase 4 announcements. As for Avengers Endgame, back to Avengers Endgame, at this point, it's already surpassed Infinity War's foreign haul and is just about $60 million behind Infinity War's domestic take. I'm taking that into account to try and figure out how much is left in the tank when it comes to Endgame, potentially. And there's also some very strong competition about to hit, and the MCU focus is about to quickly shift to Spider-Man with a trailer expected to hit tomorrow, with some major story reveals, not just for the movie, but for where the MCU is potentially headed. So I would say, with all that in mind, Avengers Endgame has about $300 to $400 million left in the tank, which would mean it would not unseat Avatar and it would not crack $3 billion. But again, when it comes to the MCU, never say never. But that's my guess. And I would not be sad about that because 2 billion in 11 days and unseating Titanic are quite the feathers in its cap or in stones in its gauntlet, right? Some of you are probably like, I want all the stones, and I understand you, but you're just going to have to maybe be happy with these two. Plus, hey, it's got to have lit a fire under James Cameron, right? And I think some of us would really like to see some of those movies. He's got four of them supposedly coming, and anything that maybe makes them a little bit better would be appreciated. And also, by the way, those Avatar movies are also now owned by Disney, something else that Bob also acquired and was not homegrown. So as for the box office, some other movies actually did open this weekend, hoping to counter program, but failing spectacularly so. There was a close race. It was very far behind first place, but there was a close race for second place, with The Intruder ending up being the big winner for the weekend. Not only because it was able to claim that number two spot, but because it did so for so much less money than Long Shot did, both in terms of advertising and the actual budget of the film. Couple that with a B cinema score for Long Shot, although oddly, The Intruder didn't get a cinema score, but I would say that audiences have snapped their fingers on Seth Rogen's career, at least as is. But speaking of Disney, I mean, I'm saying, you know, Seth Rogen, maybe he could reimagine himself, but, you know, I think he can't continue to go along as is. But speaking of Disney, as I said, at least he's in the upcoming live action, The Lion King, as the voice of Pumbaa. Charlize Theron, though, meanwhile, is an Oscar winner, gamely trying something outside of her comfort zone, so I think she should walk away unscathed. Ugly Dolls had the same budget issues as Long Shot, not enough bang for Styx's buck. But this coming weekend, the real competition arrives with Warner Brothers' Detective Pikachu, which is expected to either deliver a strong bolt of lightning to Avengers Endgame with an impressive 80 million debut, but there's now some concern that it might have stage fright and only open with a mere 55. And that 70% Rotten Tomatoes score ain't helping. The Hustle and Palms are hitting theaters, hoping to appeal to the Mother's Day crowd, and Rotten Tomatoes scores should help here as well. We'll make a real difference, because they are not helping Detective Pikachu. But I think particularly for The Hustle, which some moviegoers seem genuinely interested in, they're on the cusp, and I think it would take it's interesting. 70% I think is not great for Detective Pikachu, but that would be a blessing for The Hustle, and would probably push a number of people over the edge to maybe purchase a ticket for Mother's Day. What's your Mother's Day movie? Share it down below, and I'm also curious how many times you have seen Avengers Endgame, and how many times do you have left? Are you done? Or do you think you might go a couple of times more? And be real honest about it. Some of you I know are hardcore Marvel fans and might be like, oh yes, I'm going to go like four more times. Come on, be real. The movie's already made a ton of money. Let's try and get an honest assessment, a snapshot of how it might do in the coming weeks. So again, share those thoughts down below. That's this week's Movie Math. Thanks for going over the box office with me. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.